Well, good morning. In the next talk, Martin Jones and Justus Winter will talk about cross-site request forgery, how it is done, and how to avoid it. Please give them a warm welcome.
Good morning, Berlin. In the next about 60 minutes, we will talk about cross-site request forgery, also known as session writing. We want to kind of raise awareness that this is actually a serious vulnerability, nothing that can take lightly. And then we show you how what you can do if you write web applications to avoid cross-site request forgery vulnerabilities. And also we show you what we've done on the client side to protect internet users. A very short word about us. We both come from the University of Hamburg. I'm the researcher, work at the project Secologic that you can visit at Secologic.org. Secologic is about secure software development, especially for web applications. Justus is one of our students and also a contributor to Secologic and kind of our webmaster. Okay, before we talk about cross-site request forgery, we have to briefly talk about web application authentication, because as you probably know already, cross-site request forgery is an attack on web application authentication mechanisms. If you look at these mechanisms, then you can do a classification and you can find two different classes. There's for one explicit authentication. Explicit authentication are mechanisms where the web application or the web, web server itself is responsible for tracking the authenticated state of the user. HTTP is stateless, therefore there has to be an external mechanism that keeps a state between a couple of requests, and with explicit authentication, the web server or the application itself is doing the tracking. There are two major forms. It's a URL rewriting. In this case, session tokens are included in every URL. Or it's form-based session tokens. In that case, all hyperlinks are replaced by HTML forms that contain the session identifier and a hidden parameter. We won't talk about those today because they are immune against cross-site request forgery. Therefore, if you use those, you should be safe on that side, but those two solutions have other problems, so they are not really recommendable. All the other authentication tracking mechanisms, cookies, HTTP authentication, IP-based schemes, I will tell you later what that is, and client-side SSL, they are all vulnerable to cross-site request forgery, and I will tell you why. All those authentication forms we call implicit authentication. The reason for this is with implicit authentication, the web browser is responsible for doing the tracking of the authenticated state. That means after an initial authentication dialog, so the user logs on, says, hi, I'm Martin, my password is foo, the web server does some magic trick to tell the web browser, hey, this guy is authenticated. Every further request this guy sends should be authenticated itself. In the next four slides, we go briefly about, we'll tell you briefly how those four schemes work. I think cookies everybody here knows. Who doesn't know how cookies work? Okay, so anyway, with cookies, after the web server has sent the authenticator cookie, this cookie is included in all further requests to the web server. So all requests that match the domain of the web server that has set this cookie receive the authenticator cookie automatically. And so the web server is able to match HTTP requests to authenticated users. With HTTP authentication, it's a little bit different. It's not that different in practice. The implementation is different. In this case, the authenticate mechanism is actually part of the HTTP protocol. The main problem is HTTP is stateless. Therefore, also the authentication mechanism in the HTTP protocol is stateless. For this reason, the web server has to do, the web browser actually does a pretty dirty hack. It goes like that. The client demands some restricted resource, and the web server knows, okay, this resource is restricted and answers not with a 200 found, but with a 401 unauthorized. This causes the web browser to display, please give me a name and password, and those name and password are encoded in the authorization header. And when a request for a restricted resource arrives with an authorization header, the web server checks if in this authorization header the credentials are correct and answers. To avoid that this dialog pops up for every single web page that lives in the restricted directory, the web browser somehow remembers, okay, we already have been authorized against this web server, so he inserts this authorization header automatically further on as long as the browser session lives. So again, the web browser itself is doing the authentication. Okay, I'll wait for my excellent laptop here. Okay, client-side SSL. Actually, client-side is pretty nice because we can authorize or authenticate the web server, and we can also authenticate the web user. And if we do this, we don't even then we prevent man-in-the-middle attacks. But again, is beyond the scope of the web application itself. The reason for this is SSL lives below HTTP. In the ISO/OSI model, I think it's somewhere between TCP and the application layer. Therefore, the web server itself knows some little bit about SSL, but SSL doesn't know anything about HTTP, HTML. Therefore, we can't really the interaction between the web application and the SSL authentication is pretty much non-existent. For this reason, it's completely automated. The web server says, hey, if you want to get on this page, I need a valid client certificate. The web browser, even often without asking the user, looks, oh, I get this certificate, signs, it does some SSL magic, Justus know more about that, and authenticates the user, and the user is authenticated. So SSL is also nice for stuff like single sign-on, because the user often doesn't even know that he just has authenticated himself. With IP-based schemes, this is something different. This is actually kind of dirty hack, but you find it in pretty much every single intranet of every single corporation. We got an intranet web server, and the intranet web server lives behind the intranet firewall. And every web browser in the local net has no problem to go to the intranet web server and log on the or access the intranet. Every web browser from outside, from the evil guys or from innocent bystanders that want to get to the intranet web server are rejected by the firewall. And for this reason, the firewall is used as an implicit mean authentication. So not what you have or what you know in this case is the authentication mechanism, but where you are. If you're in the internal net, you're authorized. If you're outside the internal net, you're not authorized. There are more IP-based schemes. You can tell your web server to answer only to local IP addresses or to special IP addresses or only to requests that come from the local host or with certain MAC addresses. There are a couple of mechanisms on this layer because this is on the network layer, but they all work the same and they all are implicit. Okay, what is cross-site request forgery? Cross-site request forgery, for one, is pretty old. The first advisory on cross-site request forgery is now more than 5 years old, and I think this has been exploited even longer. Cross-site request forgery has tons of names. It's like it's XSRF or CSRF. Then there was this lead security company that thought, okay, this nobody can really remember those abbreviations, so we call it session writing. And then there were some cool dudes, and they said a session writing doesn't really quit it. We call it CSERF, and I think there are even more names for this. So I think this is one of the reasons. Okay, we have a four-letter acronym, so whoever can remember that. And then we have also two other names, and yeah, nobody really knows about cross-site request forgery, what kind of amazes me. The attack is totally simple, if you look at it. The attacker is somehow able to create a hidden HTTP request in the victim's browser. And if the victim has some authorization context with some web application that uses implicit authentication, this request is executed in this authentication context and is authorized. Okay, this is an example. We have our victim here, and the victim is doing some online banking with a very good online bank that doesn't know about cross-site request forgery. And after the initial authentication dialog that is here, the online bank sets the authenticator cookie, and every further interaction that the browser does with the online bank receives this authenticator cookie automatically and is automatically recognized by the bank to be authorized. Then while the guy is doing some online banking, he receives an email and says, hey, look at this web page. This is the most cute cat you ever have seen. And every internet user likes cats, so he stops his online banking, goes to that page, and hey, wow, this is the best cat he's ever seen. What he doesn't know is that next to the cat, there's a hidden image or a hidden iframe or a hidden foo. He doesn't really care. And this hidden image references a CGI of the bank. And the CGI is a transfer CGI and wants to transfer some amount of money to some account. And because the victim is still authorized with his bank, and the bank uses implicit authentication, the cookie, this cookie is added to this request automatically, is received by the bank, and the bank thinks, oh, this guy wants to transfer some money to some account, I will do that, if this bank is really stupid. And we found a lot of stupid applications. So this is session writing, or cross-site request forgery, or CSERF. What is the cause? The cause of cross-site request forgery is that a web application fails to verify that the request that needs authorization was created within the application. So it has the origin in the application, and it has the goal in the application, or the target. I'm pretty sure cross-site request forgery. We have a cross-site request, and it's forged because it's invisible. So the name actually tells everything. There are two tag methods. One is we can forge GET requests. This is pretty easy. We can do this with image tags or some other tags that create HTTP requests. But we can also forge POST requests if we create, for example, a hidden iframe, and this hidden iframe is filled with a HTML form. The HTML form is then submitted by JavaScript. We can also do this with pop-up windows and other stuff. So post request forgery is not that hard. If you don't have JavaScript, it's a little bit harder. Then you have to do convince the user to click on the web page, but this often is also possible. Hey, you have won. Click on this to get your prize. So this all works. We can do some more classification. There's reflected or local stored cross-site request forgery. Reflected is what I've shown you. The attacker creates a web application or a web page that then does the attack, and therefore the attacker has to somehow convince the victim to visit that page. With local stored, in this case, the application itself allows users to include arbitrary elements into the application that and themselves create HTTP requests. For example, if you have a bulletin board and this bulletin board allows users to upload images of themselves and the URL is not checked, if there's really an image behind that, then you can create an image URL that points back to the application itself and does something stateful like delete everything or lock the user out. So local attacks are pretty nasty. They are really hard to find and they are really hard to defend. Therefore, this is something the application developers themselves have to look after. We have found tons of real-world exploits, and the next four slides, we will show you a couple of more interesting finds. This is something that wasn't discovered by us, but by, I don't even know. But this is a nice example how real-life applications that actually have customers and they're actually where money is made with are vulnerable. And this is, in this case, Netflix. Netflix is an online DVD rental place where you can rent DVDs with a web interface, and you say, I want to watch the Goodfellas, and then this place sends you the DVD. And when you send the DVD back, you get the next DVD, and some money is deducted.